Why, hello. Let's do an oil painting. I've got these stick Blick paints that I haven't used yet that I kind of want to play with. We're going to see. Gamsol, an easy-to-use bottle. My palette knife. Love my palette knife. It's dirty because I use it, you know, gloves. If you're messy like me, use the gloves. I know it's not fun, but if you're an oil painter and you're messy, just wear the gloves, please. So we're going to use lots of blues and purples and very cloud-like things. I'm thinking clouds. I want fluffy, ethereal things. We're using my Bob Ross liquid white. I use this stuff all the time as a base because I like painting wet on white. Because I'm a quick painter. I like going quick. I'm not a big fan of doing long-term paintings for, you know, weeks and weeks. Not my fan. This good old clean Bob Ross brush to put in the liquid white onto the canvas, and you gotta work it in. You gotta just spread it all around. You only need like a pea-sized amount on each little canvas. You don't need much at all. It goes along. That bottle goes a long way. But the thing is, you gotta blend it everywhere. You need like a very thin layer everywhere. Literally everywhere. So that's how much was left. We're gonna open up this blue. Or is this purple? I don't know. We're going to see. It's a surprise. Oh, there's the purple. Okay, so the other one was blue. Can't see so easy sometimes. But this is a really pretty color too. And this one is not Dick Blick, but it is one of my favorites. Might as well use it. Why not? I got it. I use torture devices to open these things sometimes because my hands just don't like to open them. You know, it is what it is. I don't know how many of you out there are old enough to know what this is, but that piece of plastic that I put those paints on are... That's actually a transparency film that used to be on those very old school transparency machines that you'd use like in a college or in a school of some kind to put something on the big blackboard. I got a box of those forever ago, and I've been using them for years as kind of like a palette, just because they were cheap and they work. And the box is probably going to last me another decade just because there's like 500 in there and I'm just going to keep using them. But here we go. And blending in the blues and the purples into that liquid white. And you see how easy it goes and how pleasant it is to blend it into the canvas. Now, of course, this is super sped up because of course it is. But it actually helps the process of making everything blend into each other real nice. And of course, you don't have to buy the actual branded Bob Ross liquid white to do it. You could just, you know, thin down some titanium white and make it yourself. And that would be fine. Just a little bit of titanium white and some Gamsol, and you mix that up and use that instead. I'm sure that would just be fine. But I have the liquid white, so that's why I'm using it. You know, use the supplies you got. Enjoy the supplies you got.
Good old Thalo Blue.
New color. My beloved Thalo Blue that is... Oh, how do I describe Thalo Blue? I feel like I have to re-describe it every single time that I use it in painting. But it's a very versatile blue in that used very lightly. It's almost like a neon robin's egg. But you can use it so thick. If you use it super thick and build it up, it becomes almost black. That's how versatile that blue is, and I love it. Oh, I love it so much. So I use it pretty often. It's just my go-to blue that I use for a lot of different paintings. So it pops up in my paintings. It is what it is. It's just one of my good friends. You know, sometimes colors are friends, and that's a good friend of mine. New brush, by the way. Fresh brush. And we're going to take it off palette knife, just because we don't want to waste any paint. We might as well. See, I don't have much in the brush, and we're just gonna add it into the painting. We're just gonna blend it in very, very slowly and softly to start making the shapes of the clouds in that background. But wait a sec, I got distracted. It is what it is. But I'm not a big fan of these Dick Blick paints. They're just not that pigmented. I kind of expected more out of them, and I'm kind of disappointed. There's not a lot to them. But you know, sometimes with art supplies, you get what you pay for, and this is definitely one of those cases. They weren't that expensive, and I'm going to mix up some pastel now, because we're going to add some more detail to the clouds, and we want some more substantial pastel. Yeah. Maybe a little more pink in there. Wouldn't that be nice in the bottom part? That's what we're going to do, because this atmosphere is going to be very cloud-like, very ethereal, very windy and buoyant. Very buoyant. Oh yeah, that's what we want. Because you're not even going to be able to see this planet. You're not even going to be able to see the ground. All there is sky and cloud. And what's below it doesn't matter. Because the people who live here don't even go to the ground. They don't at all. They live in the clouds. They live in this beautiful atmosphere above all the things that are below. Maybe the below atmosphere is too hostile. Maybe there are birds in the sky. Bird people. Yeah. Another fresh brush. See, the problem is with the wet on wet style is that there is always so much blending. So much blending. So what we're going to do is we're going to make some more pastels. Maybe pastel purple, more pastel pink, maybe some pastel blue. And, you know, I'm just mixing up that zinc white. I think it's zinc white. Zinc white with the basic colors that I'm using to make a slightly more pigmented pastel color that will sit on top of those transparent colors underneath. When you're working wet on wet, you gotta actually pay attention to which things are transparent and which things are opaque, because I mean, it's essentially all the same layer. You're not, since it's all in this blending into itself, it's not, you know, I'm not waiting for this to dry so I can do another layer on top. That's not what I'm doing. This is all wet. So the pro tip, don't drop it while it's wet, because, you know, you will get an entire painting transfer onto the carpet, and that's, you know, not ideal. Some people, I'm sure, are messy. I'm sure I'm not the only one. Please tell me I'm not the only one. Fresh brush. I don't think I've used this one yet. It is like a bullet tip almost. I don't even know what these are called, but it's like a hog hair bristle, so it's like a stiffer bristle. And the reason why you use these with oil paints is that you can add a bit of texture with them. They leave a nice little texture. So this kind of brush I don't like in the beginning, but when I get to more detailed parts, it's kind of nice when I'm trying to add more detail into stuff. It's quite nice for that. So what I'm doing here is adding almost a little bit of a crown formation in the cloud. Because you know, when you're a kid and you looked up into the sky and you tried to make pictures of the clouds, what did you always imagine? Did you imagine different shapes or different landscapes or different people? Or what did you think of when you saw different cloud shapes in the sky? Because I've always been a very imaginative person, in that it's always been very easy for me to imagine entire landscapes and entire different worlds. And it's kind of what I daydream about the most, because I find it very interesting. And I like that. The part of fiction that allows you to think very large and to question things in a way that you're still allowed to live in the moment, but also be able to think bigger than the right now. And that's kind of what this is in an art form. It's fiction in an art form. That's what this is. It just is. Because this is a world of cloud, a world of very airy people, of living in the sky. So what kind of art do you think these people would have? Do you think it'd be a very visual kind of art? Because it wouldn't be a very substantial sort of physical kind of thing if they live in the sky. So maybe it was more based on colors, of changing the colors of the cloud in the sky around them. You know, like, you know those powders that you can throw into like a fireplace to like change the colors of the fire? Maybe something like that. I don't know. What kind of art do you think? Okay, so here, artist secret. Here we are. I didn't like this. We're just gonna wipe this part away. So the fun thing about oil painting is that if you don't like a part and it's still wet, you just wipe away your sins. Nobody's gonna know unless you're dumb like me and put it on the internet. See? Y'all know because I put it on the internet. And clearly, I have not learned my lesson yet. But really, in reality, the reason why I do add stuff like that is because a lot of starting artists don't understand. Painting is not all sugar plums and fairies and such. Fresh brush. Now, this is a weird one. I don't think I've used this one for anything in particular, but it's like a kind of pointy tip. We'll see how I like it. I don't know. And here's where I'm going to add the birdhouses for the sky people. This is where they're going to live, in the clouds, above all of the land below, and not even deal with the land.
Colors of the wind people.
But what I leave in the mistakes that I make, because I think it's an important thing for a beginning or even like a mid-level artist to see, or even professional artists to see. It's important to be able to see other artists make mistakes. It's important. It's important to see the growth. It's important to see that even once you've been doing this a very long time, you still have so much room to grow. You still have so much room to learn. It doesn't stop. The learning never stops. Because the truth is, the artist eye has always been edited. You know, the painting that the old masters have made has always been an edit.
Things are always edited.
It's just the old masters would do it in their head. And nowadays, people can do it with software. Things have always been edited. These kinds of pieces of art are never meant to be the most realistic things, realistic depictions of life. They're not. Art has always been an idealized version of what life could be. It's never supposed to be a direct description of what life currently is. And I think the problem is a lot of people don't, don't have the ability to critical think. I think people have lost the willpower to think critically about a lot of things in life. And I think that's part of the problem. I'm waiting for people to realize that
you're supposed to actually think about this stuff. You're not supposed to take things as they are face value. You're supposed to actually think about it. That's what art is for.
That's what pictures are for. That's what paintings are for. It is a way to communicate and a way to make you think. New color. I'm going to add some yellow because we're going to add some lights into this. I think that would be nice. Just imagine somebody's home in some of these. Yeah, so maybe some of these are have some nice house parties where they have some music going and maybe some hors d'oeuvres out. I think I'm hungry right now. I need to go get something to eat. But, you know, they nice pleasant parties in the sky as the sun sets. New day's coming. Be prepared for it. Bye. Oh yeah, and keep your cup full too.